understand that I have the honor of being the first guinea pig in this experiment. And only yesterday during lunchtime, I was told that I have to make this presentation in this session today. And I was not given this freedom of refusing unless I wanted to be downright rude. So my presentation is going to be very different from what the presentation could have been if I had more time for preparation by looking up relevant data and statistics. So anyway, so my job is not to present my own point of view, but to sum up what I perceive as a kind of collective wisdom of this distinguished gathering. So what I shall try to do is to try to present a collective point of view and interspersing with my own observations and my own points. So although I am supposed to do this job for the panel one, I found that the discussions in these various panels are quite interlinked. So very often I shall have to touch upon issues which were discussed in the other panels. So first, let us see if there are some points about which all of us seem to agree. So one first point was that Indian science is not internationally competitive at present, and there seems to be complete agreement on that. And then the next point about which we seem to agree is that we should try to just increase the volume of our scientific output without bothering too much about quality at the present time. The basic idea is that maybe the peaks of science are the fluctuations around the base. So if we broaden the base, then there are possibility of, I think, more peaks. So certainly, probably, we cannot have a sensible science policy of how to create more CNR rows, but probably we can have a policy of how to create many more Anrab Rai Choudhuris. And if the number of an average working scientist is increased by a factor of 10, maybe there will be a few more CNR rows coming out of that. And the last point, well, I should also mention that in the first half of 20th century, Indian science has been particularly lucky. At that time, though our science base was rather narrow, but we had several spectacular peaks in the form of Raman, Bose, Shaha, and Ramanujan. And I feel that this was not just some quirk of statistics. That was a time when science was more of a gentlemanly pursuit, when a brilliant individual working in isolation with very small facilities could scale the pinnacle of science. But now that age is completely over. In most areas of science, that is no longer possible. So we have to invest heavily in science if we want Indian science to scale those peaks again, which Indian science scaled in the early 20th century. And the third point, which is most worrisome, is that our competitiveness has decreased in the last 20 years, and several speakers gave various statistics about that. And I personally would not have been too worried that about the fact that Indian science is not internationally competitive if the gradient was in the right direction, if with time our competitiveness was increasing. But our gradient is negative, and another alarming aspect of it is that in the last 20 years, India is doing quite well in most other spheres of life. Our economy is growing at a quite a fast pace, and our standard of life is increasing, and there is biotechnology and IT, these are booming. Even in sports, in Olympic Games, we nowadays sometimes bring the bronze or silver medal rather than coming completely empty-handed. So science seems to be one major human activity where India seems to be sliding down in the last 20 years. And so I think we should probably try to, if we want to get at the bottom of it, probably we shall try to analyze what could be the possible causes for that. And that has links with everything. If we can figure out why this gradient is negative, then maybe we can think of strategies to turn around and make the gradient positive. And that will help us in increasing the volume of scientific output. And that, presumably, by statistical fluctuation, would lead to some peaks and that can make Indian science competitive. So something seems to have gone rather wrong in the last 20 years. So let us see whether what could have gone wrong in the last 20 years. And several speakers mentioned about that. And one is that a career in science is now considered much less, perceived as much less attractive. Many speakers pointed out that this is a worldwide phenomenon, but for us, it is much more, I believe, that much more urgent problem. About 20 years ago, boys and girls from many middle-class Indian families used to think that a career in science is one of the good prospective careers. But now, with the change of economic conditions and the creation of many new types of jobs which did not exist about 20 years ago, now the career in science is regarded as one of the non-remunerative careers. And as Professor Wadia pointed out, that it may seem somewhat banal, it may almost seem undignified to bring up this issue in this distinguished gathering, but certainly the salary of scientists is something, an issue which cannot be swept under the carpet. If we want to attract many young people to science, that is one thing which we have to keep in mind. But if you ask me what is the most serious problem in the last 20 years, why science's India is sliding down, I would say that there is this near complete breakdown of our undergraduate education system. So you know that since the Second World War, US is the world leader in science. And that is a country where undergraduate students are taught by scientists of the caliber of Linus Pauling and Richard Feynman. So in India also, we had this tradition, as Professor Datta Gupta mentioned, that some of our pioneers like Jagadish Chandra Bose and Prafulla Chandra Rai taught BSc classes in Presidency College. So even about three decades ago, Professor Rao himself taught in Kanpur IIT. And from my own personal experience, I can tell what electrifying experience a great scientist teaching in an undergraduate class can have. So when about 30 years ago, when I was doing my BSc in Presidency College, I had the good fortune of having one of India's greatest theoretical physicists as a teacher in our BSc class, Professor Amol Kumar Rai Choudhuri. And his teaching was something which would just transform our perception of everything. And some time ago, when he passed away, some of us were trying to do a head count of Indian theoretical physicists. And by my rough estimate, about 30% of today's internationally reputed Indian theoretical physicists studied their BSc during this in Presidency College during 25 years when Professor Rai Choudhuri was teaching in that college. So I believe that he is one man who has done much more for Indian physics than any of us sitting in the research institutes have done. And here I'd like to make the point that though there are some problems with our school education, as Professor Amitabh Mukherjee pointed out, but still we feel that up to class 12, things in our schools are not too bad. And then when we look at the graduate school or at the PhD level, I would say that within the last 20 years, the opportunities have actually increased for doing a good PhD in India. When I was doing my MSc in IIT Kanpur, we were told that if you want to do a good PhD in physics in India, maybe TIFR is the only place where you can go. This physics department of IISc, where I am now working, at that time had a rather negative image. We used to hear that people in that department still do things which were just done in Raman's time. So I think, again, probably the credit goes to Professor Rao for transforming that department. But anyway, so we have this peculiar situation that up to class 12 things are not too bad, and at PhD level, actually the opportunities of doing good research in India has increased But there is this in-between missing link where there is a complete breakdown in our system. So not only that not many good young kids are being attracted to science, but because of the large population in India, when some of these good kids, a few of the good kids who are attracted, we cannot nurture them properly. When some of the young students come to me and say that, I want to make a career in science, what shall I do after class 12? I do not have any answer to give. Well, lastly, I was rather surprised that almost no speaker discussed one other point which I consider very serious, what has gone wrong in the last 20 years, is dwindling job opportunities of professional scientists. So in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, many research institutes were coming up in India, and they were in the growth mode. So in my own field of astrophysics, about 20 years ago, even a mediocre person could quite easily get an academic job in a research institute. But most of the institutes have saturated by now, and that is no longer happening. In astrophysics nowadays, even a much better person often has great difficulties in getting a job. And what is particularly disturbing that often senior people who are not any better than the young job applicant sit in judgment and say that, this person is not so good. And I suppose that this issue is also linked with our this complete breakdown of undergraduate education. So in many of our universities, this faculty appointment procedure has gone completely haywire. In a country like the United States, you have universities of various grades. So people who do not get jobs in the best universities, they can look for jobs in the second best universities. And those who cannot get jobs in second best universities, then they can look for jobs in the universities in the next rank. But here in India, we have almost a situation like a Boolean algebra. You either make it or not make it. So somebody who is a professional scientist nowadays only looks for job in the limited number of research institutes, and if you cannot get a job there, there is just almost an abyss. There is no intermediate level where you can look for jobs. So I was happy that yesterday Professor Rao and Professor Balaram made this point that we have to increase the number of scientists in our country, but neither of them mentioned who will give jobs to the scientists. So that is, I think, an extremely important issue. And we often, while we talk of increasing this base of science, we often have the double standard, that we often have this mentality that when we become members of some exclusive club, we want to keep others away from that club. For example, I often hear that this argument that IIS should never grow any more in size. So I myself do not understand the logic behind it. I think that IIS as an institute should start an undergraduate program, maybe in a place not very far from near us, in the large open spaces there, and should increase probably the size of faculty and student intake. So if these are the problems, what are the possible roadmaps? So possible roadmaps. So one very important thing which has everybody has talked, that's improving undergraduate education. So there are suggestions of setting up centers in Kolkata and Pune. And there is another suggestion which several people made, that we can think of faculty movements from institutes to universities. So my distinguished colleague, Professor T.V. Ramakrishnan, decided to go and teach in Banaras Hindu University after his retirement. Maybe after spending several years in a research institute, maybe even at an age of 50 or 55, some people may want to go to the university system and teach there. And we should have some kind of a national scheme for this kind of a free movement. So, and also, as Professor Desiraju pointed out, maybe these changes would be just like cosmetic changes. we should address the basic issue of revamping the university system. So if some of the working scientists move to the university maybe at the age of 50 or 55 and take part in faculty recruitment and things like that, maybe over the years we can get the right kind of people in the universities, and that can again rejuvenate our universities. And several speakers talk about, I think, funds and remuneration, especially Professor Chattopadhyay showed us some plots showing close correlation between the fraction of GDP spent and the scientific output. So certainly we have to think of funds and increasing remuneration, but there again I would argue that we should not think of our exclusive club of few scientists working in this ivory tower institutes. When we argue for increase of salary, we should argue about increasing the salary of college teachers and school teachers. So unless we make the college teaching and school teaching these attractive professions and we have right kind of people who can inspire our young minds, we are not going to get anywhere. And then Dr. Arunachalam made the very important point that we should set up some sort of a observatory for monitoring our scientific performance. And many persons pointed out that some of the indices like the citation index or Shanghai University ranking, these are based on flawed methodology. But if we take the point of view that since these things are based on flawed methodology, we can just ignore those things and be happy, that I don't think is the right attitude. If we have this kind of an observatory, one of the jobs of that observatory should be to develop alternative indices to measure science where we have a level playing field. And what do I mean by a level playing field? For example, in the Shanghai University ranking, one of the this criteria is the number of papers in science and nature. And most people in this room know that in science and nature, about 90% of the papers are not refereed, they are directly sent back to the authors. About 2 years ago, I and my student did some work which we thought is interesting. We first sent it to science, first sent it to nature, and within one day, we got back the reply that your paper is not of sufficient interdisciplinary interest. And then we sent it to science, and for some reason, science decided to send it to two referees who gave very good reports, and that paper is now quite highly cited. So I am sure that if our address was Cambridge University instead of IISc, then I'm sure that Nature would have sent that paper for referring. So that's what I mean by level playing field. There are certain criteria which are used for which there is a sociological bias against us. So we have to develop, I think, scientometric indices in which we have a level playing field. And maybe if this observatory come up with a sort of a new kind of ranking of universities, maybe everybody will start using those kinds of indices instead of using the Shanghai University ranking. And since I am running out of time, I think I don't want to go into details of some of the other points I mentioned, I have put down here. Maybe let me make a comment about this very last point, which is somewhat dear to my heart. So many of us in this room have done our PhDs in some of the top universities abroad, and that was a fantastic experience for those of us. And here I am often feel surprised that whenever foreign students apply to IIS, of course we know in spite of our science, our institutes not doing so well, IIS may be one of the top institutes in a large geographical belt from Middle East to Indonesia. And we receive applications from foreign students, and we often view it with an eye of a suspicion. In our Senate meetings, often very incredible statements are made how we have to be cautious about, I think, foreign students. think if we want to have a sort of an image of a really scientifically progressive country in the world, we have to aggressively attract good foreign students and good foreign postdocs in our universities and research institutes. And with that point, I would like to end. Thank you.
Very good. And by the next presentation from group two.
So I'd like to make two caveats. One is that we discussed most of these over dinner last night, and so things have evolved since the document that we have there, and probably will still evolve further. And whatever I say is my responsibility. We have to do it fully. The second caveat is that the presentations were made by people at elite institutions, and we have not addressed the whole mass of university researchers, which is a whole different panel, I suppose. So the first thing is that it came across quite clearly that science is very actively encouraged in Japan and in China. And importantly, the government funding is there to support the talk. They walk the walk also. And the results seem to have been self-evident. There has been a significant increase in scientific productivity. Now, the other thing is that thrust areas have been identified, such as for instance, alternative sources of energy. And again, these have been supported with adequate resources. So finally, the last thing that came across, and that I know from personal experience, is that there's very active support, or proactive support, for international travel and for publications. And so whenever you go to any conference, you see many Japanese there, and I guess increasing numbers of Chinese. And it was striking to hear that the Chinese are paid bounties for papers in international journals, whereas we are told that we should publish only in journals with no paid charges, because they're there. So moving on to our own experiences, I believe that most of us at the so-called elite institutions do feel that the individual funding is adequate, but there are unnecessary controls in the spending and the utilization of that funding. For instance, it's hard to hire people. Whenever you want to buy a computer, you have to go through masses of procedures. And perhaps those could be simplified. Now, this leads on to the next point, which is, it's in a different order than is up there, but leads on to the next point, which is big science versus small science. Now, clearly, there's debate about how much big science you want to support and how much small science you want to support. But in a situation where we're told that funding is readily available, there surely is enough funding to support a whole variety of projects, from tabletop experiments to I'm an astronomer, so to large observatories. The difficulty is that it's not always clear that the review of these proposals is done professionally. The review is very often sent to directors of institutions. Now, okay, directors of institutions are no doubt erudite people, but perhaps not always best qualified to judge every single proposal. Now, even once money is given, money is not given with responsibility. There are a lot of constraints. Scientists are basically not trusted to be able to handle large projects. In some cases, this may very well be true, but it also does hamper us in our science. Now, one more point about this is that very often we're our own worst enemy in this, in that because the funding is seen to be limited, there's very often infighting between scientists, and not just positive infighting, not just reasons to choose my proposal over someone else's, but reasons why you shouldn't choose someone else's proposal. And when you're dealing in public policy, that kind of negative thinking is always bad, because the negative thinking, no one remembers the positive things. Everyone always remembers the negative things. So it hurts everyone. And perhaps we need a more coordinated scientific policy to address this. Something like the Academy of Sciences should have a policy document, a vision document in which they actually rank proposals from top to bottom. Now, in the institutions, many people felt, or it was generally felt, that there is a lot of freedom, which I think is true. There is freedom. You're free not to work if you want. You're free to work if you want. But this has the negative aspect too, that there's no peer pressure. If you don't work, nothing happens to you. You just simply don't work. You go to work, or you don't go to work, and you get your salary. We compare ourselves against national standards rather than against international standards. So, and as was said, sometimes in a negative way. Sometimes you put down other people rather than being proud of other people's work. And as part of this, there's neither accountability. When we're all public servants, we're paid by the taxpayer, but we're not accountable. At the same time, there's no real incentive to perform well, because there's no rewards either. You go to work, and you come back home, and that's it. Now, something that was brought out was the development of groups, and in this one example seems to be the TIFR string theory group, which does have a critical mass of people, but is difficult to maintain because of a lack of places to apply to for funding, for travel funding. There's no real project money. Now, similarly, if someone wants to hire a postdoc, again, this is difficult because many of the proposals don't support personnel. They don't. The personnel are supposed to come from the institution. But once you get into the institutional mechanism, then you have to say, why are you getting a postdoc and not the other person? So it's difficult to build up groups, and this feeds into the difficulty of support personnel also, both administrative and technical. And then finally, there is clearly, even amongst the researchers at the elite institutions, there is a low morale. And despite the academic freedom, despite the apparently sufficient funding, there's still a low morale amongst most people. I've talked to many people, and we, including me, are all depressed about the future of Indian science. And I think one of the main reasons for this is because young scientists have been disenfranchised at all levels, not just at the institutional level, or not just at the national level, but also at the institutional level. There's also way too much time spent on unnecessary procedures. For instance, if I want to bring a visitor to our guest house, I need 4 sets of signatures. There's absolutely no reason for that. Now, one thing that is important in attracting people is the salary. Now, I happen to be in the happy situation, as people said in the last session, of being the secondary wage earner. So I look on. My science is not the, I'm not the breadwinner of the family. Now, most people are not in that situation, and if you look at salaries, then it's very difficult to tell someone that you should make a career sacrifice to go into science, when there are equally exciting jobs open in IT. And I know that okay, in the old days, it was more outsourcing, more boring jobs like Oracle had. But now they're really doing exciting things. And you get as much intellectual stimulation by working in GE for a decent wage as you do in any institute. And I had two specific recommendations. One is to pick up on Srikant's point yesterday, which is that funding should be given at very early levels, with some freedom to spend that funding in the manner desired. At the same time, you have to maintain accountability. Give people a year, 2 years, whatever is right, and then make sure that they don't get further funding unless they're producing. With the freedom, with the funding must come, with the responsibility must come accountability. And the second thing there are all sorts of national policies that can be made, but these all take time and are politically difficult. But on the other hand, there are a number of smaller reforms that are fairly simple to implement. For instance, why do I need 4 signatures to bring a visitor? Just simple things. And 80% of the frustration can be solved by just 10% of the procedures. And I would really encourage this group to bring in active researchers, starting from students, bring in to talk to people like students, young scientists, all the way through, to find out what the problems are that affect their careers or affect their work, and solve them one by one. And so, this is, people should be brought in again, like I said, at all levels, into policy making, both at the institutional level and the national level, all levels. Okay, and so we'll write this up in better detail, but.
Thank you.
Good morning, Professor Sena Rao, Chair of the session. Panel 3 was on science and technology institutions. It was chaired by Professor P. Ramarao. Panelists were Gautam Desiraju, K. Vijayaraghavan, and T. Jayaraman. And the report, I'm going to make a presentation on the deliberations of this panel. And the working group which prepared this report consisted of Meera Bindur, she's here, Dr. Ravi, Dr. Sharad Anantamurthy. Yes, they asked me to make this presentation. What I propose to do in the 10 minutes time that is given to me is to summarize what actually happened in the session rather than trying to talk about each individual's recommendations. So I would like to bring in a sociological perspective to look at this whole question of the institutions. For purpose of clarity, we would deal with science as an institution and scientific organizations or scientist location organization settings separately. Science as an institution means a set of norms relating to what to know, how to know. These are basically the cognitive norms. Today, science is carried out in organizational settings. Organizations also are guided by norms regarding sharing of resources, space, time, etc., for doing research and teaching. See, for example, the cognitive norms that I was trying to refer to deals with what is the right problem to tackle at a given point in time, how this problem is selected. This, of course, depends on the community of scientists in a given specialty, and of course, this depends on the communication among the specialists in a particular specialty. That's why the journals become important, conferences become important, and peer review becomes important in suggesting what is the right direction for a specialty. And then the scientific specialty also requires social reproduction, in the sense you should have PhD students coming in to do research, and also you should recruit people who are going to take forward a particular specialty. And that is why it's important to pay attention to getting good quality students and good quality faculty members to carry out this scientific research. That's why new faculty must be preferably more accomplished than existing ones. It's very, very difficult to judge. Recruitment should be based on rigorous peer evaluation by experts in the field rather than personal judgment and informal rules. And then when we do research, basically we are going to use methodologies which involve use of equipment, use of space, and all kinds of materials. And this is where the scientific research is connected to organizations. So for example, because science is carried out in organizational settings, organizations have certain norms, and these organizations have to be reformed. Okay. Then the next one, what are the organizational reforms that we should really focus on? See, I think there's no point in saying that this should be done or that should be done. At what level these things should be done is very, very important. See, for example, can you go back to the earlier one? Yeah, this one. Okay, more autonomy means use the autonomy of the organizations to evolve our own norms. Otherwise, it's quite possible that the deputy registrars and assistant registrars will apply the general service rules of the central government or the general financial rules of the central government. I think it's very, very important to evolve norms which are appropriate for scientific organizations. I said in the absence of such norms, the rigid, uncreative, outdated rules are going to be applied, and we have been sort of victims of this kind of outdated rules and procedures, which Jayant Murthy just now pointed out. I think these norms should be related to finance, norms relating to sharing of space, equipment, etc. All these have to be worked out by the scientists themselves. And one more thing we should keep in mind is the administrative staff employed in these organizations are not trained to appreciate the scientific work that goes on, scientific research. The scientific institutions are dynamic institutions, or scientific activity is dynamic activity, and staff should be trained to appreciate this feature of science. Otherwise, the section officers, the UDCs and assistant reserves will continue to employ or apply their norms. I think it's very important to sensitize the supportive staff and ask them to provide supportive role. I think there's a need to liberalize financial norms, and yes, and autonomy in administration, well-funded R&D budget, well-funded, more money should be allocated for R&D budgets, and transparency, uniformity, and inconsistent and consistency rather than paternalistic and condescending attitude in trying to allocate resources should be one of the points of reform. Encourage and celebrate culture of dissent and criticism rather than regarding it as a nuisance or problem. Adequate funding must be given. Now, I think there was also a kind of a mention that the leaders of these institutions must be competent and responsive, and they should be chosen by a system of democratic governance, especially by contributing research. What we said was this leader should really be a competent, accomplished academician and also a good leader. Then what we should do in terms of making certain kind of, making more scientific organizations more vibrant is that we should introduce democratic decentralization of decision making. Representation of scientists on the executive bodies, whether through elections or nomination, must be carried out. Heads of the institutions must have been involved in teaching and research in the immediate past. That is, at the time of recruitment, I think there is some problem with this slide. Okay, I think the democratic decentralization is an extremely important element in governing the organizations of scientific research. How do we liberalize financial norms? How do we decentralize financial powers? Professor Ramaro is here with us. He was our vice chancellor. Great deal of things happened when he was at our universities. I think from that time onwards, things have changed really at our university. Okay, then there are also comments about how to link the So scientists have to interact with organizations, especially in the area of how research is done. They should have a say in recruitment of newer researchers and play a vital role to initiate them into research. Have a say in policy making right at the organization level or at the level of particular the national level. Have a chance to internally evaluate organization. Peer evaluation must start at the level of the organization or the level of the institution. Have freedom to network and group for research with scientists and other institutions. And there must be some norms which guide this kind of networking. And today's theory is most of the innovations take place in networks. It's no longer the individual scientist or individual scientist laboratory. Very rarely produces innovations. It is the network of scientists which produce the innovations. So there were a lot of concern was shown to reflect that the university system is kept out of research, scientific research, for the last 30, 40 years. And this situation has to change. And funding must be, infusion of substantial funding must be there. and broad-based liberal education with continuous restructuring of syllabi and modernization of labs must be introduced. And there must be interface between research organizations and universities at the level of pedagogy. These processes must be systematized and mandated or institutionalized, depending on, it should not be dependent on individuals who are heading these institutions. So unless we institutionalize this networking, this kind of interaction, things will not happen. University students should do internships, internship projects at research institutions and labs. And the researchers from these institutions should go to these undergraduate colleges and teach, or maybe universities to teach. And we should also think of reforming the undergraduate education, which Anrab Rai pointed out is completely collapsed. This is the weakest link in our entire scientific education and research. How do we reform this? Should we introduce a four-year BSc program with a project, an important project at the end of the fourth year? Or there are ideas to start with a five-year integrated program. That can be one option. I think, pardon, sir? Yeah, okay. So I'm going to take a couple of minutes, the last one. Research institutions can teach courses at classes, the universities, and influence the curriculum, and so on. By this link, the smallness of institutions can be maintained at the same time, synergy can be increased. System of cohabiting in university, research institutions with manpower and funds share physical space within a university. Teachers are given time off from teaching loads at university so that they can participate in research, while the researchers teach without much of relocation on either on their part. Equitable pay scales can be worked out actually. Okay. State of the university education needs reform. This, I think, we should bring in the UGC and the state councils of higher education into this whole discussion. By ignoring them, we will not be able to achieve anything. I think state councils of education are extremely important bodies, which also trying to reform these college education. I think there must be some kind of discussion with these bodies. I just mentioned that curriculum and undergraduate program should be improved, and there is a reluctance to change. I think there is a great deal of reluctance on part of the universities to change undergraduate curriculum because it involves enormous effort to prepare the reading material, examinations, and so on. I think the way textbooks are written also should be given attention to, and see that just because there are some new developments, old fundamentals should not be sacrificed. Okay, then of course, universities should switch over to credit system, and recruitment of faculty must be a proactive process rather than a kind of very, very rigid process that we now witness. Increasing the legitimacy of science is to see that more and more areas, geographical areas, are brought into doing science rather than confining it to a few regions, a few institutions. And similarly, premier technology institutions. Institutions of technology should reassert their role as premier institutions of research and development rather than merely providing undergraduate education. Such institutions, apart from actively sustaining a vibrant PhD program, must also not overlook the possibility of involving undergraduate and master's level teaching students, especially considering the enormous effort invested in recruiting these student members to the programs. Thank you very much.